When you read the newspaper and listen to the radio, you'll hear a lot about inflation. The inflation rate is 2.5%, or inflation is rising, or bond traders are afraid of inflation. The government has a lot of different measures of inflation. Inflation means the general increase in the price level in the economy, the rate at which all prices are rising. But how does inflation affect me? Why should I care about it? When I went to the grocery store, I bought some bread, and my favorite loaf of bread now costs $1.25. Well, that's a big increase in price over last year. I know because I kept the tag. Last year, this bread only cost a dollar. This is a 25% increase in the price of my favorite sandwich bread in 1 year. This is a lot faster than the rate of inflation as I'm reading it in the newspaper right now. My question is, at what rate are the prices rising that I care about? I don't especially care about the price of aluminum or the price of electricity. I care about what's happening to the prices of the goods and services that I purchase on a regular basis. So, the government has constructed an index that focuses its attention on the prices that I care about, the prices that households pay for the goods and services that they most frequently buy. This is an index that answers the question, at what rate is the cost of living rising? And it's called the Consumer Price Index. The Consumer Price Index is interesting to consumers because it's made up of the prices that are most important to us, that is, the stuff that we typically spend most of our money on. Let's look at how the Consumer Price Index is constructed. We begin with a basket of goods and services that represents what the typical household spends its money on each month. This basket has several things in it. The most important thing in this basket is housing. The typical household spends a fair bit of its income on housing, so we are looking at the prices of all things that go into making up housing. Your rent, your insurance, maintenance on your house, utilities, and stuff like that. So, because this is such an important consumer expenditure, the Consumer Price Index weights housing very heavily. That is, about 41% of all the CPI is made up of housing price changes. That's the most important component. The second most important component is food and beverages. That is, what does the typical household spend to eat and drink each month? Food and beverages account for about 17% of the total of the CPI, and that shows its relative importance as the government perceives it in household spending. The third component is transportation. That is, fuel, insurance, and maintenance, and depreciation on vehicles. So transportation costs, which add up also to about 17% of the total, because they're important to households, get a large weight in the Consumer Price Index. Whenever transportation prices change, that feeds into the government's measure of the household's cost of living. The next component is medical care. And medical care accounts for about 7% of the total. This is the money that people are spending on doctors and medication and such like. So we'll mark 7% here to represent medical expenditures. Then we've got clothing. What are you paying to keep yourself warm and stylish? And clothing prices, also important in this index, get a weight of about 5 or 6%. And finally, entertainment. The government looks at how much you're spending on vacations, recreation, movies, and the like, and that adds up to about 4% of the totals. That leaves a residual, what the government calls other goods and services, and other goods and services adds up to a total of about 7% to give us a nice round 100. So if you want to know what makes up the Consumer Price Index, here we've color-coded it for you. Housing, food and beverages, transportation, medical care, clothing, entertainment, and other. All the things that I care about, that is what I spend money on as a household each month. When the Consumer Price Index changes, you're spending more or less depending on the direction of the change. A rise in the Consumer Price Index means that the cost of the goods and services that you're typically buying is rising. That is, the cost of living is increasing. And the rate at which the cost of living increases tells the rate at which your salary has to increase if you're going to maintain your lifestyle. Now, How do we use the cost of living index? How do we use the CPI? Who is paying attention to it? Well, there are a couple of reasons why the CPI is important. The first is the CPI is actually figured into labor contracts. There are a lot of unions who negotiate their wages for 2 or 3 years out using the consumer price index as a measure of the cost of living. These contracts have cost of living adjustments built into them. So the union, the employees, and the employers all agree that they'll use the government CPI as the official measure of the cost of living. And when it rises, wages by contract rise along with it. Also, the consumer price index determines the rate at which Social Security payments increase. That is, the cost of living adjustments built into Social Security payments look at the CPI as the official measure of the increase in the cost of living. So the CPI is something that people watch and actually build into their contracts as a measure of the cost of living. When it goes up, a lot of people's wages and Social Security payments go up automatically with it. Another reason you should pay attention to the CPI is the increase in the CPI is often used to measure what we call the real interest rate. The real interest rate is the return on your savings measured in terms of purchasing power. That is, how much extra purchasing power will you have next year if you put a certain amount away in the bank this year? If you put $100 in the bank this year, next year you'll have $110 if the interest rate is 10%. But how much of that is actually spendable money, and how much of it is just holding you even for the effects of inflation? Say the inflation rate is 4%. That means your savings has to grow at a rate of 4% just to keep your purchasing power constant, just to account for the increase in the cost of living. If the nominal interest rate is 10% and the inflation rate is 4%, that means 6% is the real interest rate. Beyond inflation, you're getting a 6% rate of return on your money that's actually coming out in terms of real goods and services that you can buy that you couldn't afford last year. So take the nominal interest rate, subtract the rate of inflation, perhaps measured by the CPI, and what's left over is the real interest rate. The real interest rate is what households pay attention to when they decide whether they're going to save money or not. When the inflation rate is high and the nominal interest rate isn't high enough to compensate for it, I'm not going to save my money. Why let it sit and rot in the bank? Why let it sit and my purchasing power shrink? No, I'm going to spend money today. But when the real interest rate is high, I see that it's worth my while to delay consumption, and I put the money in the bank and I enjoy more purchasing power in the future. Now, there are all kinds of price indices. We focused in this discussion on the consumer price index. The consumer price index looks only at a subset of all the goods and services available in the economy. But it's the subset that a consumer cares most about: food, clothing, housing, entertainment, medical care. Another index that we can consider is the producer price index. It's a broader index. It includes a lot of other stuff. And it includes the prices that are important to producers and their profits. It includes the price of aluminum, the price of electricity, the price of all kinds of raw materials and other inputs that go into the production of the goods and services that consumers buy. The producer price index includes a lot more stuff. And it should be important to you if you're trying to make predictions about what's going to happen to your own cost of living in the future. That is, if producer prices are rising today, it won't be long before producers, trying to protect their profits, have to pass those rising costs on to you in the form of higher consumer prices. That's why we call the producer price index a leading economic indicator. It points toward what's going to happen to your own cost of living in the future. Each of these cost indices, whether it's the consumer price index, whether it's the producer price index, whether it's the GDP deflator, each of them is designed to answer a particular question. We've talked about the consumer price index. It's trying to answer the question, what's happening to the cost of living as households perceive it? The producer price index answers the question, what's happening to production costs and what might happen to consumer prices down the road? Every index has its own question to answer. All told, they are indicators of inflation, the general rate at which prices are rising across the economy.